Everybody they should hear what I have to say. My baby, pretty pretty baby, oh my sexy lady, I can't wait for our wedding. And on that day, happy birthday goes to just.
Hello everyone, and welcome to another positive, uplifting, God blessed us Sunday. I hope that your week has started or ended on a positive note. And I hope that when you come to today's woman, you are inspired, you are uplifted, and you have a purpose on your journey. You have guidelines to start your week on a positive note. My name is Michelle Lato, and as I always say, I love to give inspiration for the day. So let's take a look at what we have for the day, and we'll be right back. Today's guest is someone who is going to be speaking to us about architecture, the importance of architecture when you're building your home, because it's important to have the right structural foundations, the right structural frameworks to be able to have your dream home sustain and live through generations and a lifetime. I wouldn't want to spoil the surprise about what we're going to learn on her profile, but her name is Karen Evans-Halm, and she's a co-founder and CEO of Spectra Global Limited. Let's take a look at what she has to say, and let's have a great conversation about architecture and what you need to do. Let's take a look.
Our guest today is described as a strong woman, an entrepreneur, and an architect who will overcome every obstacle in her path to see to it that whatever she sets her mind to gets done. She's a co-founder and COO of Spectra Global Limited, where her focus has been on shaping and strategic positioning of the company for both local and global opportunities in the industry. She's an award-winning principal architect with a demonstrated history of working in the architecture and planning industry. She creates designs with an Afro-chic philosophy that serves a client's need to acquire bespoke buildings without having to deal with the stress of construction, as she has applied her skills in business management and organizational leadership to build Spectra as a design building firm. She's a member of the Ghana Institute of Architects and currently serves on the executive committee of the construction sector of the Association of Ghana Industries, AGI. Let's welcome Madame Karen Evans-Halm.
Girl, you have to knock them out. She wants to shake it up. Hi, Karen.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good.
You look good.
Thank you.
Please have a seat. So, Karen, I've always wondered, and I've known you for some time now, I've always wondered what goes through the minds of architects. Take us through the process of what even made you decide to become an architect. This was many years ago, right?
Yeah, very, very. I was very, very young then.
Okay.
Probably when I was now trying to enter the secondary school. And so the issue was, so what course do I read?
Yes.
Do I read art? Do I read science? Because I qualify for both.
Okay.
But then I had a big brother who was studying architecture in Nigeria then.
Okay.
And so he was like, okay, before we even make the choice, we need to find out what's the next step.
Okay.
After secondary school. And I was like, okay, so I love to do stuff with my hands. Mm-hmm. I like to build things. I just like to see things come alive.
Exactly.
And she was like, okay, so what about architecture?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, okay, tell me a bit more about it. Because he was then taking the course.
Yeah.
And so he told me a bit more about it. And then I'm like, why not? But before I could even go to read architecture, I started sharing with people, oh, I'm going to school, I'm going to read architecture. You know, I was so excited. And then everybody I told that I was going to read architecture, their first thing is, hey,
uh-huh,
can you read architecture? One, the course is long.
Mm-hmm.
Two, it's difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Three, by the time you get a husband to marry because uh-huh, your level will be too high.
Uh-huh.
Four, your baby production. I'm like, hey,
slow down.
Whoa.
Take a chill pill and tell me why not.
Take it easy.
Yes.
And you know, the funny thing is, the more I got people to tell me you can't do it,
yes,
I was like, really?
Mm-hmm.
I'm so going to do this.
Yes.
And so I followed the dream and then I went ahead. But I had this, like you're just sharing, this
natural
things with my hands and stuff, mm-hmm, like that. So in addition to going through architecture, I also developed interior design and landscape architecture. So it's more like Architect Plus.
So, okay, you mentioned three things: interior design, architecture, and architecture design.
And landscape architecture.
Landscape architecture. Yeah. So it seems like they're all interconnected. It seems like they all come from the same family. Mm-hmm. When you took that leap of your faith and the trust in yourself to want to actually study architecture, did you have all of these other subjects encompassed in this main subject? What did you really zero in on?
So I zeroed in on, you know, I went to school in KNUST.
Okay.
So it's when you go first year, they give you the canvas.
Yes.
So they teach you everything. Mm-hmm. Everything with space, everything with environment, everything with psychology of everything that has to do with the built environment. Mm-hmm. And then as you progress in the program, you begin to pick out the ones that you are drawn to. Uh-huh. So as I progress, I realize that these other aspects of the practice were getting more exciting mm-hmm. for me.
So you focus on architecture.
Yes.
And to me, I mean, we all know that without an architect, and for some of us that don't, without an architect, the house really doesn't exist. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Can you tell us the importance of architecture? I mean, why is it so important to have an architect? Because I mean, there are cases where, you know, we go online, especially nowadays, you know, we can go online, go on YouTube, go on these apps from the App Store and download these ideas, these, you know, finished products of houses that we aspire to have. And so if you have a picture of the house, is it really important for you to have an architect to design the same house, and why?
Okay, so I'm going to take it in two parts. It is good for anyone who wants to own a home
okay.
to shop for ideas.
Yes.
So you get to see, you begin to put together, we call that the vision board,
yes.
right? So you begin to put together the kind of things you like in a building, the kind of colors, the kind of finishes, the kind of, even the kind of plants and so on and so forth. So that by the time you get to your architect, mm-hmm. the diagnosis is like 40% done.
Right.
So they get to know what it is you are looking for. Mm-hmm. The architect will not, in quote, photocopy mm-hmm. what the various ideas you send to him mm-hmm. or her. But what they can do is they begin to understand what you really desire. Your mind.
It's a male-dominated area. Why are you in that field?
Well, when I was going into it, I did not know
okay.
it was a male thing.
Okay.
I just wanted to build stuff. I just wanted to create things. And then the course available in the university that I could combine the visual arts, I could combine science, I could combine math, was architecture.
Okay.
It was when I got in and I checked my class and I realized that, whoa.
Were you outnumbered? Were you outnumbered?
Yes. I could count the number of girls on one hand. The rest of us
were
guys. Then I began to realize that, okay, so this is... But in school, they don't give you a kid's glove treatment just because you're a woman. Mm-hmm. The marking scheme is the same for mm-hmm. all of us.
Exactly.
If it's an A, it's an A. And, you know, because architecture is a visual thing, mm-hmm. if the work is good, it is good. Mm-hmm. If it's not working, it is not working, and everybody can see that, mm-hmm. right? So on campus, if it's an A, it's an A for her, it's an A for him. If it's a fail, it doesn't matter whether you're male or female, you have failed. And so that's how we're trained on campus.
What you love about architecture, tell me, Karen. Because your lights up the moment you speak about designing and seeing things come to life. What do you really love? Do you love the process of receiving someone's vision board? Or do you love the process of conceptualizing something that you see yourself?
I like the part where I conceive something, translate it to paper, and actually see it
come
in
to life.
Reality.
Yes.
Now it's off the paper.
Yes.
And I'm looking at it, and you know, the most satisfying thing also is when I see the look on the client's face, mm-hmm. and the person is very pleased and be like, okay, I did it, mm-hmm. right? It's very, It's very fulfilling.
Was it always like this for you? Because in the beginning, you've gotten your certificate, you're a certified architect, you went out into the active world, you introduced yourself as an architect. How did you begin? How did you begin to win these hearts of people that smiled from the outcome of your visualized sketch into reality? How did you start off?
When we're on campus, you know, once you practice or when after learning architecture, by the time you are in third year, fourth year, you can design buildings, really. Residence, you can actually do that. You start to do the high rises in postgraduate, like fifth year, that is when we start to do. So by the time you are in third year, really you can design the basic stuff. And so being daring as I am, when I was on campus, when I get a project, I would do it. So somebody would say that, oh, okay, so I have a little two-bedroom house. Can you design it for me? I'm like, hey, why not? You know, and so that is where I started. And then when I came back, reality began to set in when we came out of school. And then I got married. And then I started popping babies.
I was so enthralled with what you're saying. All of a sudden you said popping babies. Okay. So, can you be a bit more graceful about the process of having you delivering babies? Beautiful.
Okay. Delivering babies.
So the reality struck because because you were working overtime and you had deadlines to meet. How long have you been in this business, by the way, of designing homes?
I've been in business for, the business is 10 years.
Okay.
And I've been 15 years out of school.
Okay.
And so as part of the professional training, when you finish school, you have to work under a certified architect to get your certification before you can move on to do anything you want. So that was the trajectory. I was a teaching assistant. I was retained as a teaching assistant on campus. And then after that, I went to work in a firm, did my professional exams, and then went into academia. So that's, and then after academia, I went to mainstream.
So what was
practice.
The first house that you had to design? What was the first project that you worked on? This is about 15 years ago. You're starting off, you know, you're now going to put into practice everything that you've learned in this male-dominated class that has all the men that are literally like churning out all these floor plans and these concepts. You came out 15 years ago. What was the first thing that you did? I want you to take us back.
15 years ago was the first thing that I did.
Was it a bungalow? Was it a house? Was it a building? Was it an office? Was it a housing project? What did you really have to do?
It was a residence.
A residence, okay.
Yes, it was a residence for, I remember this so well.
Good. It was. Take us there. Was it a good
Michelle,
or bad experience?
We've gone through things.
I mean, we want to know how easy is it? I mean, you know, without the likes of you, and I'm going to come back to that, so you better start recollecting some of the highlights. Without the likes of you in the making of homes and creation of homes for some of us who, you know, aspire to have our dream homes, like you said, on the beachfront or up in the hill, out, you know, in country or out country, we don't have homes. And this is something that I'm going to stress on, because without the architect who designs and sketches, plans, creates quantity or alongside your quantity surveyor, the quantity of materials that you need, the foundation that is necessary to be able to sustain this building that's going to have you and your family and everybody else in time for a long time, you don't have homes. So I want you to take us back as to where you were that first day. You've come out of university. Yeah. You are flaunting your certificates. Hola, finished. I'm a certified architect. What was the first thing that you did? Whose residence did you do? And what was the experience like? At this point in time, you were hands-on, Karen?
So it was this gentleman whose name I would obviously not want to share. But I remember I went to his office in light industrial area, and he gave me this site plan. He wanted A, B, C, D. And so we looked at the brief, and then I put together the design for him. His site was in East Legon.
Okay.
After you know, when you finish school, you just want to design.
Yes.
You just want to build things.
Yes.
So things like
did he underestimate
business,
you?
Business management, okay. And how to manage finances, and you are not taught that,
okay.
Right? And so what I should have done was to conclude on my fees. But we just had a little discussion. I thought we were on the same plate, at the same level of understanding,
yes.
With the fees. And then I turned in the work, done floor plans, everything, 3Ds, everything on point. And then I deliver the work and it's like, oh, in TCC, I know you any day. I'm like, hey.
What does he mean? He thought that possibly that you were not business savvy and that you didn't have the legal counsel and possibly didn't he have the experience in business administration.
So he thought that he could just,
you know, protect yourself.
This is a young girl. Mm-hmm. I can just give her anything.
Okay. Okay.
You know, because we had agreed on the fees.
And ladies agreement.
Exactly.
Right.
So, the terms was once I deliver the work, you give me my check.
Yes.
But now I have delivered the work and you're asking me, so what do we do? Well, the check.
Clearly. Okay. Okay.
So after that, what I started doing was doing things like terms of payment.
Okay.
And so I will do the commitment fee.
Yes.
To make sure that you also have some skin in the game.
Yes.
And then, so I give you, if I deliver this, you pay that. If I do this, I connected the
terms of payment.
Yes, with some deliverables.
So for some of you watching,
somebody one day who said that he will buy me cooking utensils. I'm like, guys, seriously.
He will buy you what?
Cooking utensils.
Wow.
I know.
I mean, we're not going to say no to that, clearly. But I mean, a professional service is a professional service.
Yeah.
And for some of you who are venturing into any area of profession, be it being a makeup artist or be it an architect or be it an interior decorator, a designer, the advice and the lesson from this is that you know, put your terms of commitment or engagement in place from the onset.
Yeah.
You know, have an agreement. And nowadays, I mean, I definitely advise that you seek professional counsel by going to see a lawyer. But there's also very basic documents that you can find online, like NDAs, non-disclosure agreements, MOUs, and the likes of those to protect your interests and your client's interests. So, I mean, that's definitely a lesson that you learned, and I'm glad that you share that with us as
yeah.
well. I want to really touch on aside family as well, because you did mention that, you know, family was part of, you know, the one thing that you had to, that you did, that you popped babies, and so you slowed down your progress.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask a few things regarding your perception or your view on the state housing and the state of that. Because as an architect, which you're part of an association here in Ghana, what is the plan and when is that plan going to be implemented to make sure that the deficit in the housing sector for the majority of the masses is going to be seen to? What is your view on that? And when is that going to be implemented fully? I mean, there are pockets of projects that are being done, but as a collective, as you are, as architects, have you come together as a movement, as an association, to seek these policymakers to ensure that this is done for the masses? What's the view on that?
Okay, so with the issue of state housing and affordable homes, I've been asked that question quite a number of times, and I say that it is not a one solution thing. You have people you are designing for.
Mm-hmm.
You have to consider what they want, right? And then you also have to consider their ability to buy or pay for what you have. And then you also have to look at the land that you're going to put your developments on. You're going to have to look at amenities to the place. Right? And then you also have to look at the various components that go into each of these structures. Now, I'm going to take the first one. In terms of what the people want,
mm-hmm.
as architects, we have come up with various options.
Okay.
Okay. Of building materials, various solutions of home sizes.
Mm-hmm.
That, well, is not at the luxury level,
mm-hmm.
but it could work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But then we find that many a people want the finer, higher market products.
Okay.
So we have some of us who have done research into earth buildings, and I'm not talking the traditional village type, but things like that have been like stabilized earth, like it's been improved upon. Okay, so and you can even finish it in such a way that it looks like this normal concrete blocks that we have. But what we realize is that people don't quite want it. The perception is still that.
Are you saying that this is the reason why the implementation of state housing projects has stalled? Is it why that we're not? Is it the reason why we have not been able to create, to not just create actually, to provide housing, shelter? Can't we use sustainable products? Can't we use sustainable materials that are definitely found naturally here in Ghana? Can't we use any form of materials that are affordable, that still have the safety features, that still have, you know, again, environmentally friendly, and something that the government, I mean, even you as an association can propose to the government? Isn't it something that can be done?
We have researched into things like container housing.
Okay.
We have researched into the earth. Mm-hmm. And then we have research into things like modification of internal partitions so that you don't use the same expensive products on your exterior walls as you would on the interior walls. But yes, scientifically it makes sense, but it doesn't go down well.
Okay.
I cannot speak to why state housing is not, or we are not seeing it, because that is a government thing, but I can speak to the private sector, right? And so those are some of the things. And with the private sector, for example, developers are there. I also have my own development where you are fighting with land. Okay, so you see land, you pay fully for the thing before you even start. But then you have to pay two times, you have to pay three times because of litigation issues. And sometimes you even have legal documents. You have your land title, you went to do your search. So you went through
the double sales.
Yes, you went through the process, but then you hit ground and then somebody comes and says that, no, you should have bought the thing for me. The other one was my brother. Well, as a developer, where do I transfer the cost, right? All of that is all part of cost of the goods that is being developed. And then secondly, so that if we could have things like land banks that probably the government could give to certified developers and so on and so forth, that would help so that you don't have the issue of buying land two times, three times, or even having to cough up the money up front before you even start. And then another thing is, because of the kind of taste that our markets want, we have to import just about everything. The only thing we have locally is sand, stone, water, and cement.
But we have steel as well that we're fabricating here locally, don't we? It's a dream that's achievable. I think that if we all came together with one common vision board and one main mood board as well, we can achieve our dreams. I mean, it's not too late to have conversations like these, because I think conversations like these stir up some reality checks that it's time to make some changes and to provide to the masses that also support, that also make up the entire populace, because we all need and we all deserve to get and have the best. We have to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, a bit more about family and Spectral Global. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after the break.
Our host, stylishly glammed up by Fast Choice Beauty, CVL Beauty, Apricot,
Pistis Ghana.
Welcome back, and I promise to show you, as I've always said at the beginning of the show, that we'd want to demonstrate, to illustrate, and also to educate some of us that don't quite know some of this information. I didn't know for a very long time that there was a difference between the architectural design and the engineering design. All of these design concepts are very critical in making up the foundation, the fittings, the materials, and even the end finished product that we all love to see, which we will go into details in a bit. Now, we're all aware that the pandemic, the coronavirus, has not left us just yet. And it's probably going to be here for quite a number of years. We have to be reminded to take safety practices. And so I have a message for you that comes from GTP, and it reads specifically and especially for you. Your life matters, so take good care of yourself. You need to wash your hands with soap under running water as often as you can. And if you don't have access to soap or running water, please do use a hand sanitizer with 70% alcohol-based. Please, there's a wide array of options available. Don't forget alcohol or washing your hands under running water. It's important for you to eat well and to rest well to keep your immunity boosted so that you can fight any disease and any virus, and stay active. Exercise is very important. Please do follow all these safety protocols brought to you by GTP, still timeless. Now, this part is the part that I love the most of the show, because here we get to expand, we get to ask a few more questions, and we get to also see in practical format what they do and what they really mean. So, Karen, I'd like us to look at some of the things that you have on display here, because time is not really our friend today, and I really want to know a lot more about you. Whilst you're telling us about the process of creation, I want to just quickly show some of my viewers how it really begins. Now, we spoke earlier on in the first part of the show about creating your vision board. And we also touched on how to create a mood board that will give the sense of feel, the vibration, the I like to say energy, because energy is very important. But let's use a much more normal word, such as the ambiance in your household, by using mood boards. Now, you have here on display some very basic, and like an A4 sheet and some designs that have been sketched on a sheet. Is this how it really starts?
Well, this is a modified version of how it actually starts.
Okay.
So this is like stage, yeah.
Like doodling.
Yeah.
People doodle. Okay. So this is the stage, what do you say, four? Stage four?
Stage two, stage three.
Stage two.
Yeah.
So this is like design version of it from her mind or from the client's mind on paper. Then you proceed to which step? Show us.
Okay, so after that, after you have all these ideas coming at you, you just put them on paper, mm-hmm. and it doesn't have to be in any particular format. As the ideas are coming, you're just translating it.
Okay.
And then another major thing that we do is you are putting the structure on a land, okay. or a piece of land, or so which we call the site.
Okay.
And so you have to do your site analysis. You have to study the site.
Okay.
What is around the site?
Okay.
How big is it? What is under the site?
Yes.
What is above the site? Because whatever it is you're going to put on the land, mm-hmm. has impact on what is going under it, what is happening around it, and so yes. on and so forth, even how deep you want to go.
Yes.
So before we come up with a development like this, mm-hmm. we'll have to do a soil test and all of that to make sure that the soil that we're going to put the buildings on can actually accommodate it.
Yes.
And if there are issues with the land, what can we do to make sure that it actually works?
I'm so glad that you said that, because I've noticed a number of houses in some communities where you notice some form of porous, like surface on the walls. Is it because that's mainly because the building has probably been built on a waterlogged area? Is there a problem with the building materials? Is there a problem with the land? Just really quickly, what exactly do you think it is?
Some of the times we have high water table.
Okay.
But for normal residences, many people don't do the soil test.
Okay.
And so they just dig and then they start moving on.
Okay.
Right? And then it's only a matter of time. Water will always find its level.
Mm.
It's just a matter of time. You know, the concrete and the concrete blocks that we use,
yes.
they are not waterproof.
Okay.
And so the water finds its way through it. And then before you know it, they're climbing up your walls.
You're making me want to take architectural design and engineering design, because, I mean, it seems like this finished product is just a sketch, you know, a printout. But it goes, there's so much that goes into it. You know, mm-hmm. the soil testing, integrity of the materials, the analysis of the area. All of these factors make up a long-standing, sustainable house and even project that in your, for offices or whatever you may need it for longevity purposes. I would love to have 10 more minutes with you so that we can touch on a few more and go through all of these site plans that you've done. But let's just quickly look at Spectre Global, mm-hmm. and what this project is and how you've been able to juggle as a mother and as a wife designing at the same time. How have you been able to do that?
It's a lot of planning and systems.
did they inspire you to create something like this?
Well, to create something like this, this is an investment-related project,
okay.
really. And so by the time the client comes to you, he knows his numbers.
Okay.
So we have two different methods,
okay.
right? The situation where if it's an investment-related project,
yes.
you start from the cost perspective,
okay.
and then you work backwards.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's a dream project, for example, the beach house I gave an example of, mm-hmm. obviously, okay, so let me share this with you. We have what we call the consultation, pre-design consultation.
Okay.
And what we do with the pre-design consultation is that when you come to us with an idea that I want to do, let's say, this development, in addition to the site analysis and so on and so forth, we also do cost analysis.
Okay.
And so with that, we're able to let you know that this budget that you have is adequate for the project or is not adequate. Sometimes some people come to us and they don't know exactly how much it's going to cost. Mm-hmm. So they come with a whole shopping list.
Mm-hmm.
I want this swimming pool. I want gym. I want this. I want sub-business. I want
cinema. I want the dream house.
Exactly. And so before we start the main design, we do the analysis and we give you the numbers.
Okay.
So that you are aware that, okay, so this idea that you want to bring to reality, this is actually how much it's going to cost you. Now, the interesting thing is that when we've done that, some people go like, oh, is that so? Okay, take this out. Take that out. You know, the Bible says that whoever built a house first has to count the cost,
mm-hmm.
right? And so we help them to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So before you go into your project, we help you count the cost. And some of them are able to go like, oh, okay, I can actually do this, add this. Or no, let's come back a bit and take some things out.
I am so proud of you.
So for this project is an investment. The land is just an acre and a half. And so, and we knew the number of units we had to put on. And so you realize that for this one, we had to do a lot of vertical planning because the land size is finite, but we still needed to have some numbers on it. And so we had to do that juxtaposition to make sure that it's interesting. And then the client also has his return on investment.
Do you apply this amount of passion, dedication, explanation, and this kind of structure in your household? You have three children.
Yep.
You have three children that are really young. You have a husband that is, I'm sure, very demanding of your time as well, and rightfully so. You're such a beautiful woman, very, very, very intelligent, and very talented, because you did say that you saw this 15 years ago, well, before you even went into it, you took the leap of faith. You were in the midst of a male-dominated classroom, but you stood steadfast and studied the subject and came to show us an outcome of what you can do. How are you able to juggle all of this? Coming up with concerts for clients, projects of this size, residential communities, business complexes. How are you able to juggle all of that and still be able to be the architect of your household?
Okay, so I do a lot of planning in my home. I have things like meal plans,
mm-hmm.
chore plans,
mm-hmm.
Garden plans.
Mm-hmm.
there's a system and a plan for everything. So in terms of managing the home, I have a whole system, who does what, when it has to be done and all of that, because without that,
mm-hmm.
you're just going to run all over the place and you can't get anything done in the economic world, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I have that. That is what I do. And then I also use the support systems around me.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, if I have to travel for a project and my kids have to go to school, my mom is still alive by the grace of God. Thankfully,
mm-hmm.
my mom is still alive. So I take them to my mom's. When I come back, I go pick them up. And so these are some of the things that, and I'm also teaching my children alongside. So there are times that, for example, I had to come here today, so I had to leave home very early in spite of everything else that happened.
That's another story for another show, by the way.
But I've trained all my kids help with cooking
mm-hmm.
various meals. So
you
they
have
know,
a good balance.
Yes, so yeah. they know how to make some basics. I'm like, so I told my firstborn, okay, so today I can't make breakfast,
mm-hmm.
but this is what is on the menu. You know how to do it. So how about doing it for your younger siblings?
Mm-hmm.
And that is how it worked. So I could come here. So it's a lot of balancing, it's a lot of systems, a lot of using support. And to remain calm,
mm-hmm.
I have to make sure that I always spend time.
With God?
With God.
Mm-hmm.
It's... I cannot overemphasize that.
I can relate to that.
Yeah, it's just because sometimes things just get out of hand and you, but you have to maintain your cool, and you have to keep composed. And so playing a lot of gospel music, talking to God about whatever the issues are, and then before you know it, things have simmered down.
It is possible to be a professional career woman, a mother, a wife, and also probably someone that gives to your community in any capacity. This was to say to you that in spite of the fact that it looks very technical, it looks extremely mechanical, Mrs. Karen Harm has been able to juggle by creating structures, frameworks, and systems, not just in her professional life, but also in her household. So if this has been of any use to you, take inspiration that if you create structure and create planning, you will be able to have some organization in your life. I'm an organized person. I can totally relate to you. I use Excel sheets for everything. And I also use a diary where I create columns and lines, so I separate my activities and my tasks for the week. And I always say the week because it's best for you to plan your week ahead. Mm. Karen, I'm so glad that you repeated this to camera and also to our viewers, because it's important for us to share some of the practices that we do and use in our household, in our lives, so that it can help somebody else not feel so overwhelmed and discouraged to take a leap of faith in being something that they've visualized and they've also aspired to be. If you want to become an architect, if you want to be a talk show host, if you want to be a lawyer, a dentist, whatever profession you want to go into, and even if you're already in it, you can always make it better. On that note, it was such a pleasure to have you. I would hug you, but I cannot. And I will definitely come to you for you to give me some designs, design concepts for all of the projects that I also have in my pipeline, big and small. And again, it was a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much, Karen.
Thank you,
Karen.
So much.
It was a real pleasure.
It's been an honor.
All too soon, all too soon. Time hasn't been our friend today, as it hasn't been on most Sundays. But know that I'll be right here on your screens each Sunday on TV3 at 3 p.m. You can also watch me live on Facebook, and the information about where to go is right underneath your screen. But today we learned quite a bit, because the importance of creating a blueprint from inception when you're building your dream home, if you're expanding, if you want to now do renovation works, it's very important to speak to an architect, because they always say that cheap is expensive. Don't invest in something that you have to reinvest in the next 3 to 5 years. Do it from the inception, invest well, plan well, and know that everything will be fine. Stay blessed, stay well, and don't forget, God's got you. Bye-bye.
My sexy lady, I can't wait.